Anyway, good afternoon and welcome to this talk on colorectal cancer. I'm Borys Mascarenhas. I did my fellowship training at the University of Pittsburgh in surgical oncology and have been here in Lake County now for 7 years. The first thing I'd like to speak to you about colorectal cancer is that the incidence, it's the third most frequently diagnosed cancer in the United States. There are about 105,000 new cases each year, and of these, 56,000 result in deaths each year. We've noticed a decrease in the actual mortality due to colorectal cancer, and this is because of early diagnosis and better treatments available. This is a rather morbid slide for you to see when you've just eaten lunch, but I just want to show you the different parts of the intestine. This is the colon, which is on the outside. The part on the right is, it's called the right colon. Your appendix is attached to this area here. The part which is horizontal is called the transverse colon. The part which is coming down here is called the descending colon. The S-shaped portion here is called the sigmoid colon, and the lowermost portion is called the rectum. This will have implications because we generally discuss cancer of the colon and rectum separately, though they have a lot of common features in the treatment. Now, here are some of the risk factors for developing colon cancer. There are certain polyposis syndromes, which are genetic disorders, which are passed down from family to family. The most common one is the familial polyposis syndrome, in which one of the genes is abnormal. So you first get polyps occurring in these patients, and then if they undergo another gene change, you then develop frank cancer. So we have to be aware of these people and aggressively monitor and treat them. You have a second type of colon cancer, which is also hereditary, but it doesn't involve polyps, and that's called HNPCC, which is hereditary non-polyposis colon cancer. A lot of people have a family history of either having polyps or colorectal cancer. Now, inflammatory bowel disease, it mainly consists of Crohn's disease or ulcerative colitis. And these are two common inflammatory bowel diseases, and they give you an increased risk of developing colon cancer, especially if you've had it for more than 15 to 20 years. There's also a history, if you've had a history of colorectal cancer in the past, it makes you more likely to develop another one. Or if you've had a history of colon polyps in the past, you have a higher incidence of development of colon cancer. This is a cartoon which I found amusing. It says, open your eyes and see what's happening in your colon. Another one which I found was the judge telling the convict, he says, the jail cells are full, so I'm going to let you off with a colonoscopy. So how do we screen these patients who fall into the high-risk group category? If you have familial adenomatous polyposis, it's required that you have annual screening at adolescence, which is very young. If it's normal at age 24, then every 2 years till age 34, every 3 years till age 44, and then if everything is normal at that point, then just revert to average screening. Why are we so aggressive with this? Because this is a disorder which almost certainly will lead to colorectal cancer. So we have to be very aggressive in looking out for this problem. HPNCC, I told you, non-polyposis hereditary colon cancer. It's recommended that you have colonoscopy every 1 to 3 years, starting at age 25. If you do have a family history of colon cancer, it's recommended that you have a colonoscopy at the age of 40, or 3 to 10 years earlier than the youngest member of your family who's been afflicted with this problem. Now, what if you have a personal history of a cancer or having a polyp removed? They recommend that you have colonoscopy within 1 year of having surgery, and if this is normal, then you can have one every 3 to 5 years. What if you have inflammatory bowel disease? I told you the patients with Crohn's colitis or ulcerative colitis. They recommend you have an annual colonoscopy after 8 years of having the disease in patients whose colon is completely involved, and that's what pancolitis means, or after 15 years in patients with only left-sided disease only. What happens if you fall into the average risk group, which is most people anyway? They recommend that beginning at age 50, you have an annual digital exam with your primary care physician and fecal occult blood testing. The recommendations now are kind of iffy in the sense that they are not very specific and there's no standard. But generally, it's expected that you have a flexible sigmoidoscopy every 5 years, a colonoscopy every 10 years, or a double contrast barium enema every 5 to 10 years. But as I said again, the general recommendation is that after the age of 50, you should have one colonoscopy. And if that is normal, then you can have one every 3 to 5 years thereafter, or maybe even longer. Now, how do you diagnose colorectal cancer? I divide them into two categories, patients who are symptomatic and those who are asymptomatic. Asymptomatic means you don't have any symptoms. These patients are diagnosed at the time of screening colonoscopy. What if you are symptomatic? What symptoms would you have? If you have a right-sided colon cancer, it generally presents with symptoms related to anemia, with fatigue, weakness, unexplained iron deficiency anemia. And this is related to blood loss, which you can't detect. It's not overt. And why does this happen? People are more likely to develop anemia rather than have symptoms related to the colon cancer itself because the right side of the colon is very distensible. And so you get obstruction as a very late presentation rather than an early presentation. So most of the time they present with symptoms related to anemia. On the other hand, left-sided lesions present with symptoms related to obstruction. That is change in bowel habits. You can sometimes get pain, and sometimes you can have a complete obstruction and the bowel bursts or perforates. The reason why left-sided lesions are more likely to present this way is because the left side of the colon is less distensible than the right side. Now, I thought I'd educate you a bit about colon polyps. A lot of you have had colonoscopies. You get a biopsy report which tells you that you have some sort of polyp. And I just thought I'd educate you about which are the ones which are dangerous, which are the ones which are not. Non-neoplastic or non-cancerous include hyperplastic polyps, pseudopolyps, and hamartomas. These are not dangerous at all. Neoplastic polyps. These may not contain cancer, but they have the potential to develop into cancers. And the three main types are tubular, villous, and tubulovillous. Tubular is the most common type. This is a type of polyp which is attached to the colonic wall with a stalk, and I'm going to show you pictures of it. It's the most common type, accounting for about 75% of colon polyps. The risk of cancer depends upon the size of the polyp. If it is about 1 to 2 centimeters in diameter, the risk is 10%. As it increases above 2 centimeters, the risk is 30%. That means 1 in 3 at least will harbor some cancer. The second type is the villous adenomas. And these are dangerous adenomas because they account for 10% of all adenomas. What we mean by sessile means that they are broad and flat. And as many as 40 to 50% of these polyps actually contain cancer. And half of these are invasive. So when you have a colonoscopy and your gastroenterologist tells you that he finds a flat, broad-based polyp, that is most likely a villous adenoma and needs to be treated aggressively because, as you'll see, 40 to 50% contain cancer. Now, there are certain polyps which have some of the features of the tubular adenomas and have some of the features of the villous adenomas, and these are called tubulovillous adenomas. They account for 15% of adenomas, and their prognosis or their actual danger is midway between the tubular, which are less dangerous, and the villous, which are more dangerous. So about 22% of these contain cancer. This is a picture of taken at colonoscopy of a colon polyp. This is the actual polyp seen from the inside. Now, this is what you call a tubular adenoma. As you can see, this is the polyp here. This is the wall of the colon. And this is the stalk I told you with which the adenoma is attached to the colonic wall. Another picture of the same thing. Now, we stage colon cancer basically on three main factors. One is the characteristics of the tumor itself. The second thing is based on whether the lymph nodes are involved or not. And the third thing is whether the cancer has spread to any other organ. This is called the TNM classification. And essentially what the T stands for is how deep the tumor has invaded into the wall of the colon. N stands for the lymph nodes, whether there are lymph nodes involved or not, or whether, and if they're involved, how many lymph nodes are involved. And metastasis, which stands for the M, is whether the cancer has spread outside. Based on this, you have stages of colon cancer. So stage 1 and stage 2 are early colon cancer, which does not involve the lymph nodes. Stage 3 colon cancer invariably involves the lymph nodes. And stage 4 colon cancer is when the cancer has spread to either the liver or the lung, and that constitutes metastatic colon cancer. We also divide colon cancer based on the grade. Well-differentiated being G1, and G4 means poorly differentiated or undifferentiated. This is just an illustration to tell you all the stages of colon cancer. So stage 1 is an early type of cancer. It invades the wall of the colon much less as a more advanced colon cancer. And as I said, stage 3, the lymph nodes are involved. And stage 4, it's actually gone beyond the lymph nodes and spread to either the liver or the lung. This is an actual colonoscopy picture of a colon cancer itself. This is the wall of the colon seen on the inside, and this is an actual colon cancer scene. So once we diagnose colon cancer, how do we work these patients up? We obviously review the slides to confirm that the patient does have colon cancer. We get a colonoscopy, if we get an entire colonoscopy, to be sure that there are no other cancers elsewhere in the colon. We do blood work, and we do what is called a CEA level. CEA stands for carcinoembryonic antigen. And this is something that the cancer cells actually secrete into the blood. And it serves as a great marker because you'd like to know what the CEA level is before starting treatment. Because if your treatment is effective, your CEA level should come down to 0. And it's also helpful because down the line, if your CEA level suddenly starts to rise, then you can suspect that the patient has got recurrent disease. We do staging scans of the chest, abdomen, and pelvis. And you must have heard of a PET scan, which is positron emission tomography. And this is not routinely indicated for the workup of colon cancer. What we find it most useful is if patients develop an elevated CEA level down the line after the treatment, then we use the PET to search for a site which it's come back in. This just shows you actually what type of surgery we do for different types of cancers. In figure A, you have the cancer which is on the right side of the colon. And we remove part of the colon along with the end of the small intestine, and we hook them back together. Again, this is for a right-sided lesion, but this is close to the liver in a place we call the hepatic flexure. This is the type of operation which is performed. This cancer is in the transverse colon, the horizontal portion of the colon, and this is the operation which is performed. This cancer is at the splenic flexure. That means the part of the colon close to the spleen. This is the operation recommended for that cancer. This is in the descending colon, and this is in the splenic flexure of the colon. I told you the S-shaped portion of the colon. This just is a cartoon which illustrates what we do. We basically use a stapler, divide the colon and the end of the ileum, and then we put it back together in a side-to-side fashion so that the stool can now go in from the small intestine into the colon and out. Now, you all must have heard about laparoscopic, you know, colectomy versus the old traditional open procedure. Now, a laparoscopic procedure is very, very helpful for patients who have either very early stage cancers or who have just polyps. And the reason being is that The recovery time is usually a day or two quicker. It's also better tolerated with less pain. However, in colorectal cancer, we have to be very careful offering this modality to patients because you want to do an adequate cancer operation. I'm sure anybody doesn't mind a bigger scar if I can assure you that you've got a better cancer operation, which will reduce your chance of developing a recurrence. In staging colorectal cancer, we require at least 12 lymph nodes to be removed as part of the procedure to stage patients adequately. For the laparoscopic assisted procedure, experience is crucial. You should have no evidence of any advanced local or metastatic disease. That means, what I mean to say is that if the tumor is eroded through the wall of the colon, then doing it laparoscopically would not be doing the patient a favor. Obviously, there should be no bowel obstruction or perforation. And what the gastroenterologists do in order to enable you to actually visualize where the tumor is, because if you're doing it laparoscopically, you're using instruments, you can't feel with your hands. So you have to see a marker to tell you where the tumor is. And that's what the gastroenterologists do, that they inject some blue dye when they do the colonoscopy. So when you put the scope in on the inside, you can actually see the area which is involved. So once you have the surgery, then how do we follow up these patients? We do a history and physical every 3 months for the first 2 years. We do, for T2 or greater lesions, we do a CEA test preoperatively, I told you, every 3 months for 2 years post-op and every 6 months for the next 2 to 5 years. We always recommend the patients have a colonoscopy within a year of surgery. If polyps are found, then you get another one within the next year. If it's normal, then every 2 to 3 years. We recommend a CT scan yearly for the first 3 years for high-risk patients. What are these patients? These patients are those who have nodal disease or who have bulky tumors, because they are the ones who are most likely to develop either recurrent or metastatic disease. Again, I said PET scans are not routinely recommended because there are a lot of people who just order PET scans just with a diagnosis of any cancer. And this is not the routine recommendation of the National Cancer Network, called the NCCN. And they only recommend PET scans for patients who have rising CEA levels where you can't find the source of the rising CEA. So now, there's a lot of commonality involved with both colon and rectal cancer. So I'll quickly run through rectal cancer. There are about 41,000 new cases diagnosed each year. The rectum is a tube which is about 15 centimeters. The upper part, which is close to the colon, is 5 centimeters. The middle portion is 5 centimeters. And the lower portion of the rectum is 5 centimeters. So diagnosis, again, is made by colonoscopy. Asymptomatic patients are diagnosed at screening colonoscopy. Symptomatic patients present with rectal bleeding, a change in their bowel habits, and sometimes can be obstructed completely. Now, what are the adverse pathological features? That means, suppose I diagnose a patient with rectal cancer and I take a biopsy. What are the adverse things which I look for in the biopsy? That means either lymph or vascular invasion, perineural invasion, which is invasion around the nerves supplying the rectum, the size, which is actually greater than 3 centimeters. This is a typo. And if it's moderately to poorly differentiated. Again, this preoperative surgical workup is very similar to colon cancer, except that we have another modality involved, which is called endoscopic ultrasound. This is a modality which is actually not done in our hospitals here, but done usually at the tertiary care centers. And this actually is ultrasound done on the inside, almost like a colonoscopy. And this is very accurate in staging patients with rectal cancer, because it tells us how deep the cancer has, involves the rectum. And this has implications into what type of treatment we offer the patient up front. As far as staging, very similar to colon cancer. Early stages just involve the rectum. Stage 3 involves the lymph nodes. Stage 4 means it's spread to the liver or lung. Now, how do we treat patients with rectal cancer? Now, T1 or T2 lesions, I told you what those mean is that they involve the wall of the rectum less compared to T3 or T4, in which the whole thickness of the rectum is involved, and T4, it actually extends outwards and involves, you know, the other organs around it. So for early stage lesions, T1 or T2, who do not have any of the adverse features which I mentioned above, what we mentioned before, and those adverse features are that it should not be a poorly differentiated cancer, it should not have perineural involvement, it should not be more than 3 centimeters, and it should not have any lymphovascular involvement. So if you have a small cancer there which doesn't have these bad features, you can actually offer them transanal resection from below without requiring a big operation. That means without opening the belly. And then based on the final pathology report, either follow it with chemo radiation or just observation. If you have T1 or T2 lesions which don't have the good features, then you would probably have to offer them the standard surgery, which is a low anterior resection of the rectum. The problem comes is if it's in the really low rectum, less than 5 centimeters from the anal verge. In that case, you can't do the operation from the inside of the abdomen alone. And in order to do a good cancer operation, you have to actually remove the entire rectum, which means a permanent colostomy. And that's called an abdominal perineal resection. Some advanced centers remove the entire rectum and they put a part of the colon attached to the anus. But the problem with that is that, you know, the rectum is actually useful for concentrating your stool, and it's like a vault. So if you don't have that in place, then the patients have about 12 to 14 bowel movements, and it's really horrible, morbid for them. So most of them would rather have a bag instead. Now, when I talk about rectal cancer, there is something which is called total mesorectal excision. And what that means is that this is a specialized technique which involves removing all the perirectal tissues adjacent to the part of the rectum which is being removed. And why is it important? Because it's known that rectal cancer, it spreads beyond the draining lymph nodes into the adjacent fatty tissue. This technique helps to remove this disease and reduces the local recurrence from 25 to 30% to less than 6%. And that's without any chemotherapy or radiation treatment or anything else. Just this particular technical way of doing the operation. And that's important because most colorectal surgeons or surgical oncologists are actually trained to do this type of technique. And so if you have a situation where if you have a regular community surgeon who does everything including colon cancer and rectal cancer, doing this with a local recurrence rate as much as 25 to 30%, that's huge. But this has been shown considerably over different trials. And if you get somebody who can do a technique which has a local recurrence rate of 1/5 of what you're what the other person is offering, obviously you need to go to a colorectal surgeon or a surgical oncologist who understands and knows this technique. What this means is that you actually take out, in addition to the lymph nodes which are surrounding the rectum, you also take out the fatty tissue surrounding it, because this is the area which can harbor cancers. I just thought I'd put in this slide. All this shows is that with the total mesorectal excision, okay, you had a local recurrence rate. And these are huge studies involving a lot of patients. This involves 1,411 patients. This one, 1,748. And as you see, the recurrence rates are anywhere from 0 to, in one small study, 12.2, but most of it's about the 6 to 7% range. And then if you add chemotherapy and radiation to it, you're looking at excellent results in terms of long-term outcomes. If the tumors in the rectum, I told you about endorectal ultrasound. So if you do an endorectal ultrasound and you find that your tumor is either a T3 or a T4, which means extending out of the rectum or into the surrounding tissues, then to do surgery there is not the treatment of choice. In those cases, we first do chemo radiation and we shrink the tumor down and then follow it with surgery. Now suppose the patient before these chemo radiation complains of severe pain in the rectum, which indicates involvement of the sphincters. Even if you have a good response to the chemo radiation, it's recommended that we remove the sphincters at the time of surgery and give the patient a permanent colostomy, because that is associated with the best results. Now, what happens if you have a T3 or a T4 lesion, you have chemotherapy and radiation, and then when you have a repeat colonoscopy, everything looks fine. There's no evidence of any cancer there where they did the biopsy. We still recommend surgery for those patients because when you look at the specimen, even after what looks like a complete response, 50% of those patients will have viable cancer cells remaining there. Now, what happens with patients? Suppose I work up a patient for colon cancer and I find that it's already spread to the liver or lung. These patients are generally treated with chemotherapy first, and then we reevaluate the situation. And based on the response to the chemotherapy, we then go after the disease if it's localized to a particular area. In patients who have disease in the liver and lung, but if either they're completely obstructed or they bleed, in those patients, we offer them as surgery as upfront, even though the disease is spread there, because if we don't do anything with surgery, the bleeding can be life-threatening, and the obstruction can cause severe problems. The surveillance for colorectal cancer is very similar to colon cancer, and I won't go over that again. So in conclusion, the decrease in mortality in colorectal cancer is due to advances in surgical technique. As I told you, total mesorectal excision and other forms of advanced surgical technique, radiation treatment, and chemotherapy. There are definite outcome differences when colorectal surgery is performed by a surgical oncologist or a fellowship-trained colorectal surgeon when compared to the regular community general surgeon. These differences are mainly due to advanced techniques like total mesorectal excision, as well as the number of lymph nodes removed during surgery, which clearly affects the outcome. I thought I'd give this a cancer survivor's poem. It's a beautiful poem. It says, "Cancer, such an ugly word. For me to get it, oh, how absurd. But cancer came knocking at my door, and it was quite a shock, that's for sure. But I know that God really loves me, and so from all the fear, I'm set free. For God has promised to be with me all the time, even when the mountain is real big to climb. The birds are singing and I am still here. I have great support with the angels near. I'm so blessed in so many ways. I live life to the fullest till the end of my days. For God has got special plans for me. He's given me promises so that I can see that there's hope in the days ahead. So I've got a purpose to get out of bed." Thank you very much. Any questions, please? Question was that what are the ways of detecting rectal cancer? Is it only colonoscopy? The answer to that is that we have recommendations in terms of how we need to screen patients. So if you don't have any symptoms, what they normally do is they do blood testing, on the rectal exam to see if there's any blood. They also do a finger exam, which is recommended at the age of 50. And the recommendation generally is to get a colonoscopy at the age of 50. And if that is perfectly normal, then every 5 to 10 years thereafter. The question is, the patient here has a hernia, which he says she bleeds occasionally from the rectum. How can she tell for sure what it is? The first thing I would get is to get a gastroenterologist to see you. And, they can first of all examine you, and then possibly do a colonoscopy. And then if required, if they feel that the problem is a prolapse or something, then there are certain tests which can diagnose a prolapse. And then you would probably require a referral to a colorectal surgeon to fix the prolapse, because there are different operations with good results for that. The question is about test results, and the last date, which was here, was 1999. That was the table, right? That was just because most of this literature, and this is really with respect to the total mesorectal excision and what the recurrence rates were. Is that what you're talking about? Yeah. When I pull this data off, it's pretty much a proven thing in terms of, that total mesorectal excision is the standard of care. reason why I pulled out these series is that these are very large series, most of them. And it started with the first series of Dr. Held, who actually devised this concept of total mesorectal excision. So nothing has changed, you know, to the contrary, based on the literature. But the reason why I chose those series where they involved thousands of patients, a very big series. But nothing has changed, you know, to the contrary. The question is, what does it mean when it says high dysplasia? Now, you grade, so dysplasia means that it shows the cells are abnormal. What it means is that they don't see any obvious cancer in there, but they see cells which look extremely abnormal. And what that indicates is that if you biopsy one part of a polyp and it shows a lot of dysplasia, you have a 50% chance that another part of that polyp could contain a cancer. So generally, it's recommended that if you do see dysplasia, that you aggressively pursue the polyp. The question is, how fast does it progress? That you cannot predict. Because in some cases, you can just have dysplasia, not any associated cancer. Those patients obviously will not progress as rapidly as somebody who has invasive cancer or just cancer in situ in another part, which will progress more rapidly. But it's literally very difficult to gauge. It's like, you know, asking me, say for example, a breast cancer. I mean, you can ask somebody, how long has this been in me? It's probably been there several months. Maybe it didn't show up on the previous mammogram, so then you can assume that it came about since the last mammogram to the current one. But could you have had something there which was a small focus, which then only became apparent now? They say the turnover time is about a year for breast cancer, but it's not a definite science. The question is the first person you get to see a gastroenterologist? What I would recommend is no. I would say usually you go to your primary care physician who does the digital rectal exam, the fecal occult blood, okay? And then they usually make a recommendation if you're over the age of 50 to see a gastroenterologist. I have not said a surgeon because I don't do colonoscopies myself. And so generally, you know, we recommend a fellowship-trained gastroenterologist to do the colonoscopy. But there are other surgeons who do their own colonoscopies. But generally, the first person you see is your primary care physician who will then direct you to the appropriate specialist. Polyps, No, especially if they're hereditary and they come, you know, because of one syndrome or the other, then you have no control over it. But in terms of, you know, colorectal cancer, I mean, there is a protection given in terms of, if you eat a high fiber diet and a lot of, you know, vegetables and healthy stuff. Because there is a definite incidence more if you eat, if you don't eat vegetables and you only eat your steak and potatoes. The question is, if the cancer has spread to the liver, how does it get distributed, and what are the potential treatments, and what are the long-term outcome? It's a very good question. The outlook for liver cancer, of colon cancer or rectal cancer spreading to the liver, has dramatically improved over the last few years. The distribution is variable. You can have people presenting with just a single spot in the liver, which makes it more amenable to surgical removal. If the liver has tumors in different places where you can't just remove them safely and leave enough liver tissue, then we have different other modalities. Most of the time, when we see a patient who has cancer spread to the liver, we generally try to treat them with chemotherapy. Chemotherapy is useful in the sense that it helps select out patients who are long-term survivors with this type of cancer. And the reason being is that it usually is pretty effective. The new chemotherapies which we have are extremely effective against cancer, even if it's in the liver. Suppose we had a patient with colon cancer who just has one lesion involving the liver, a particular lobe of the liver. Then it's some people will say, let's give them the chemotherapy, see how the response is, and then follow it with surgery. There are some people who believe that's a candidate who can have surgery straight up front. So the first thing we do is when we approach cancer which has spread to the liver from the colon or rectum is we want to see if it's only in the liver and it's not in the lung. Because if it's in the lung in addition to the liver, it makes no sense to go in and remove the part of the liver surgically when it's already somewhere else. Those patients, we give them first chemotherapy, see what their response is, and if they have response just limited to a portion of the liver, then we aggressively treat it. We have new modalities, which is called radiofrequency ablation, where you use electric current to burn the tumors. We have situations where we remove part of the liver to treat the cancer, and another part which cannot be removed safely, we use the electric current to burn it. This, coupled with the new chemotherapy, has dramatically improved the 5-year survival for patients who present with disease in the liver to as much as 30%. I just came from my meeting, and there are some studies now showing as much as 30% 5-year survival. That the question was if it spread to the bone in addition to the liver. You know, the liver seems to be a site which responds better to the treatment. The bone is less, you're less likely to get a cure with it having spread to the bone than to have a good response to the liver. And the bone you generally treat with radiation treatment, but it's usually less responsive to the treatment. The question is the CEA blood test the same as the PSA? The CEA, it's a similar test. It's a similar test which you detect in the blood, okay? CEA stands for carcinoembryonic antigen. PSA stands for prostate surface antigen. They both have the same value, okay? But the CEA level is less specific than the PSA. What I'm saying is the PSA is more reliable because you generally can have, the CEA can be elevated in a lot of conditions other than colorectal cancer. Whereas if you have a certain degree of elevation of the PSA, let's say beyond 10, then it's most likely related to prostate cancer rather than any other condition. Whereas in certain conditions, you can get a CA level which is elevated without having colon cancer. So I would say the PSA is more specific. The main value of CA, as I mentioned, is really to follow a patient who has colon cancer, and especially those who have an elevated colon cancer CA level before the colon cancer is treated. Now, some people with colon cancer don't have an elevated CA to begin with. And for those patients, it's of no value at all. So it's only if you have an elevated value before the surgery, and then you follow the levels subsequently, and if you suddenly notice a rise in the CA, then you've got to be vigilant that something has come back and go after it aggressively. The CA level has nothing to do with the PSA level. They're not connected at all. The CA level is a surface antigen for the colon, for the colonic mucosa. The prostate one is specific for the prostate. So they're not related to each other at all. They're just both blood tests which you detect, you know, which you use for screening in the blood. But they're not related to each other. What does FACS mean? It means Fellow of the American College of Surgeons. The question is, the lady's primary care physician, because she has a strong family history of rectal cancer, recommend that she have a yearly colonoscopy. The gastroenterologist didn't feel that she needed one every year. The general recommendation is that since you have a strong, you know, family history, but once you have a normal colonoscopy, perfectly normal, the chance that something could come up again within the next year is very unlikely. So the recommendation is, even if you have a family history of colon cancer, but it's not like one of those syndromes I, you know, recommended. Those have a different recommendation altogether. But say you do have a family history of having had rectal cancer. You have to have a totally normal colonoscopy. If that is the case, then every 3 to 5 years thereafter. Okay? But there's no hard and fast rule in terms of when do I need to get it done. Your primary care physician is obviously concerned about you, you know, you developing it. But having said that, suppose you have a colonoscopy. And as I said, if they, on your last colonoscopy, they took out some polyps, whatever they were, then the recommendation is that you get it yearly till you have no more polyps, in which case then you could move it to 1 to 3 to 5 years. Most of the time, the question is that Are colon polyps reflective of age, or can they come at any age? That's a good question. Most of the time, it's as you are older that you're more likely to develop a colon polyp. However, in certain conditions, as I told you, familial adenomatous polyposis is a genetic disorder where you get colon polyps at a very young age. And these have the potential to develop into cancer. So as you see, the screening recommendations are reflective of the age at which you're most likely to develop a polyp. So obviously, for the high-risk groups, we start screening at a much younger age. For patients whose families have a history of colon cancer, the screening recommendation is you start screening at about 10 years before the first member in your family got colon cancer. On the other hand, for a regular person, it's recommended at age 50 and onwards, only because that's the age where you're most likely to have a colon polyp. Most of the time, because what happens is, the question was about colon polyps and development of iron deficiency anemia. These polyps, they bleed microscopic blood. Blood which is not detectable on, you know, when you look at your stool, there's no obvious blood. And this is a constant process. So a lot of times, this is responsible for developing iron deficiency anemia. Okay? The question was about the stuff used for the PrEP which can cause kidney damage. It's mainly the Fleet's phosphor soda.
Which one?
Fleet's phosphor soda. That's what I understand. Diverticulosis is a condition which is completely different. It's not cancer at all. It's a weakness in the wall of the colon. So what happens is the inner opening comes out through the outer wall. And the problem with just having diverticulosis is very common, but it's when it gets infected and it pops, that's when you get diverticulitis. And there are various severity of diverticulitis, which is just from the mild stage to an actual full-blown perforation requiring surgery. And the other thing about diverticuli is that it can cause bleeding. So it can cause infection and call diverticulitis, or it can cause diverticular bleeding, which is usually self-limited. Thank you.